Hi, I'm Jeff Ramson, CEO of PCG Advisory. We're a full-service investor relations firm specializing in emerging growth companies and blockchain projects. Today, I have the pleasure of sitting with Laura Anthony, the founder of Anthony PLLC, a top-notch securities law firm based in Palm Beach, Florida. Laura, it's great to have you. Thank you for being here.
Thank you, Jeff. I'm glad to be here.
Tell us a bit about your practice. I know you've built a really phenomenal reputation and a great client base.
So we're a full-service corporate securities and business transactions law firm. We represent public companies, mm-hmm. and that is everything that a public company needs, including their SEC filings, mm-hmm. their mergers and acquisitions, their general corporate work, their follow-on filings. We represent private companies in all forms of corporate finance transactions, including private offerings, mergers and acquisitions, and of course we do private to public transactions, sure. which is a full-on IPO, a direct listing, a reverse merger, a lot of Regulation A+, mm-hmm. and a lot in the exciting new space of securities tokens.
Right, which is certainly the topic we'd like to cover with you today. So if you would, just tell us a bit about what's happening in the security token world and the digital security space in general.
Well, I think that securities tokens, they represent a fractional ownership interest mm-hmm. in a company, the same as a common stock does, but it's a different technology used to record and mm-hmm. keep records and to trade and to settle and clear that fractional ownership interest. And because of its decentralized nature, it can eliminate middle people and middlemen.
Right.
And the way that securities settle and trade in the United States is going to change. It is changing. The proverbial train has left the station. Mm-hmm. Recently, T0 launched this week. They started their trading, which is the first actual marketplace that's trading digital securities. Mm-hmm. And it's going to be very interesting to see what happens.
So that opens up the pathway for others to start trading security tokens?
That's correct. So it's a new technology. If you think about it, it was only back in the 70s that stock certificates were still in paper form and trading in the United States was in paper form and things became digitized and DTC became such an important part of the trading of securities mm-hmm. in the United States. Now you move forward to this new methodology of trading, and T0 uses that new methodology, which is on the blockchain. It's moving very quickly. There are several companies out there, and a branch of NASDAQ just did another round of investment in a technology company that's working on building back end. It's coming.
Right.
There's no stopping it. It's
right.
coming.
Right. Agreed. So let's go back a step to like the problems that we have, that we certainly see in terms of clearing traditional securities, especially that are for smaller companies. My thinking is that as the clearing process changes, it's going to make it much easier and the compliance issues will be eliminated or diminished.
If you can program smart contracts within the law, for example, ways to trace ownership, that could help eliminate misbehavior and bad actors
right.
that set up accounts under other people's names.
Right.
And we can help the SEC and other regulatory bodies do their job and eliminate fraud or
right.
reduce it.
So one of the things I find fascinating about the at least some of the opportunities when it comes to digital securities are really customizing the nature of the securities, right? So we know that you can do common stock-like offerings, but I'm seeing some things that maybe are more preferred stock that have some features that may not be available to common stockholders. Are you seeing that as well?
Yeah, absolutely. Not only can you have any type of security that can represent a fractional ownership interest or right, a right to royalties, a right to revenues, a right, any sort of right, a fractional right to a subsidiary or to a certain business sector, but you can drill down into smaller fractions of that ownership
right.
using digitized securities.
Right, exactly. And by eliminating middle people, by disintermediating, it cuts down cost so you can get a larger number of small investors through
Correct.
The automation. Eventually, I know at this time it's accredited investors only in these offerings, but eventually there'll be secondary markets where I would
Correct.
Say the average investor can participate.
Correct. And another beauty of it is that you can now take it away from just a company. So you can actually have a fractional ownership interest in an asset.
Right.
You could have an ownership interest in a painting, a car,
right.
any type of asset. You can now have a fractional ownership interest in that asset by using digital technology. regular technology allows you to do it too, but it's much more cumbersome than when you use digital technology.
Right, exactly. So now that T0 is trading, and do you think you'll see other companies now on that platform?
Oh, absolutely. T0 plans to have 60 companies trading on their platform before the end of the year, and to open up to non-accredited investors, much like a securities exchange or an alternative trading system, an ATS. And there's many that are behind it that are working on getting their licenses and getting their systems. Many already have a license, but getting their systems in place to launch.
So this leads to a very important point from our perspective, and I think from yours as well. We see a lot of these companies, and they walk in our door and they say, well, you know, we're a private company. We're doing a private offering. It's 506C. And I explain to them that the only way they're ever going to have liquidity, true liquidity, on that secondary market is you're going to have to be a public company of some sort, right? There's going to have to be some kind of reporting requirements and governance in order to ever create secondary liquidity or sell to non-accredited investors or even other accredited investors.
I do agree. I agree that the only way you ever have liquidity, especially if it's a private company, is if you have disclosure and you have a place, a secondary market that's accessible by other people. And that's something that the T0s and the platforms are going to offer. It'll really blur lines between private equity and private company trading and public company trading. So you could have, as long as the proper disclosures are there, a private company trading in a marketplace, in a secondary marketplace. And it doesn't have to be a full-on public company.
Right. So that being the case, it seems to me this opens up another pathway for private companies to raise money from different sources than with traditional venture capitalists, or we see a lot of companies going public probably too soon.
Yes. Right?
And then we see all the problems that go with that. So at least it seems to me that with the ability to do a publicly marketed private offering, private companies can access capital earlier, at earlier stages, and get listed on an exchange. And again, whether they are going to be fully liquid, they at least have the opportunity to be traded amongst accredited investors.
Yeah, I think it's really important that small companies have access to capital.
Right.
And having access to capital is one thing. Having a pathway to liquidity for the investors in that company is second, and it's really important. Mm. I mean, no one is really in to just hold that security forever. There has to be an exit strategy. And I think that digital marketplaces offer more options on that exit strategy, especially if they eliminate certain clearing firms and allow for investors to deal directly with each other, of course, with proper controls in place to help prevent fraud and protect investors.
Right. So if people want to contact you, where would they go?
They can go to one of my three websites, which would be the main law firm site, anthonypllc.com, my blog site, which is securitieslawblog.com, or my LawCast, which is a video blog series, lawcast.com.